Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Welcome to another live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal and this is a live program where you can ask any questions about Islam, about Ahmadiyyat, about other world religions, and it would be my pleasure to respond to your questions. You are watching this program simultaneously on multiple platforms that includes Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, Twitch, and Afrika TV. On all these platforms, wherever you are, if you're watching these programs, you can submit your questions. If you're on Twitter, you can just submit it into the main live stream. If you are on YouTube, you can use the live chat replay, not replay, but the live chat itself. And if you are on Facebook, you can use the comment section to send your messages, to send your questions. Today, I wanted to start my discussion, and before I start taking any questions, I've already started receiving them. I wanted to start with talking about what Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, alayhi salam, peace be upon him, taught. What was his teaching? There's a misconception about him that he brought something new, and some people go even so far as to suggest that he brought a new Quran. Nauzubillah, may God protect us from these kind of things. His mission was exactly what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam predicted, prophesied regarding the promised Messiah. So if you want to learn more about him, you can go to alislam.org. Right here on the main page, you have this image of him as well. You can click on that image, or you can go in the top green bar and click on the words promised Messiah, where you see promised Messiah. So you come to this page about him, and it talks about his claims, the signs, what was his message, which is contained in some of his books. So some of those books are given here that you can just click on more on any of these books, and you can learn more about him or about his teachings. And similarly, you have a lot of these books that are listed here that are now available in the English language that you can go through. Quickly, I just wanted to show you this book, Our Teaching, which is it's a very short book. It's an extract from his writing, Noah's Ark, Kashti-e-Nu, Noah's Ark, which has also been translated. It's a small extract from that book. So if you click on that book, you will come to understand what the teachings of the promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, are. Right here in the contents page, you can see what he's advising us, what he's teaching us. So he's calling us back towards the true Islam. That is his core teaching. If you want to understand the core teachings of the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, that is that he brought us back to the true teachings of Islam, the real Islam, the true Islam, which was taught to us in the Holy Quran, which is taught to us in the Holy Quran and in the Sunnah of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, something that has been lost among the Muslims. Now, a lot of people might say, well, we know the Sunnah already, we have the Quran already, why would we need Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him? So you must understand that in the prophecies, the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that there will come a time when nothing will remain of Islam except its name. So Islam will be there in name only, and nothing will remain from it. And nothing will remain from the Quran except its plain recitation. So only the recitation of the Quran will be there, but the Quran itself, the teachings itself rather, would not be followed. And he said that the mosques would be full of people, but devoid of guidance. So in light of all these things, we needed the Messiah. We needed a Messiah to come and bring us back to the right path. And that is what the mission of the promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, was and is. And this book that I showed you, and let me show it to you again, it talks about these things. And another interesting aspect of this book is that it has Ahmadiyya beliefs on page 37, and you can go right to page 37 if you're short on time, if you just want to know what the Ahmadiyya beliefs are, and they are listed here, right? you know, and I can zoom in a little more for you to see this better. It says, we believe that God exists. We believe that God is one. We believe that God is holy, free from all imperfections. We believe that angels are a part of God's creation. We believe that God speaks to his chosen servants and reveals to them his purpose. Revelation is important. We believe that when darkness prevails in the world and man sinks deep in sin and evil, it becomes difficult for him to rise again without the help of God. So you need the help of God in order to purify yourself from sins. We believe that divine messengers belong to different spiritual ranks and contribute in different degrees to the fulfillment of the ultimate divine design. And the greatest of all messengers is the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We believe that God hears our prayers and helps us out in difficulties. We believe that from time to time, God determines and designs the course of events in special ways. So all these beliefs are listed out here, these 12 points, which would make it very clear to you what the Ahmadiyya Muslim beliefs are and how we are the ones who are representing true Islam. So you can see that from that page, and you can see that these are the teachings of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, the founder of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. So now let me get back to the this program, which is about question and answer. You can submit your questions on Twitter, YouTube, Facebook, as I mentioned in the beginning. And this question, this program is open to any kinds of questions you might have about faith matters. Question from Facebook, people are saying salam, wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Question from YouTube is that what is the Ahmadiyya Muslim position on the Gospel of Barnabas? The Gospel of Barnabas, what is the Ahmadiyya Muslim viewpoint? Well, it must be investigated what the Gospel of Barnabas is, something to be investigated. Personally, I haven't explored it too much, but it is alleged that that gospel talks about Jesus Christ. Excuse me. It talks about Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, having survived the cross, having survived the crucifixion, or something along those lines. The reality is that when it comes to the Gospels, there are so many Gospels out there, and they keep on discovering new documents which could have been Gospels, but they never made it to the officially sanctioned documents, the officially sanctioned Gospels that the Church endorsed later on. This was much later, by the way. It was not in the days of Jesus Christ. It was a couple of hundred years later when the Church formally stated that these are the books that they would adhere to, or one of the church fathers made this list. So there are lots of gospels out there, and Christians reject those gospels. We do have examples of other gospels from which are known as the Gnostic gospels, right? One of those gospels is known as the Gospel of Judas Iscariot. And of course, it's not the actual Judas who wrote that gospel, but it is attributed to him. And that gospel is believed to have been written in the year 140 AD. So very early on, it was written, and that gospel exists. Similarly, there are other gospels that have been written, the Gospel of Thomas, the infancy gospel. So all these gospels are there. Christians don't accept any of these. They consider them apocryphal, right? They would consider them apocrypha. It's not authentic, or they wouldn't accept them. So for Christians, it's the Gospel of Mark, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, which they accept. The Ahmadiyya Muslim position is that the original gospels or sayings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, have been lost. This is something that the promised Messiah, peace be upon him, said. He said that the original gospel or the original sayings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, in their truly, truly authentic form, are not around anymore. Christians don't have them. None of these gospels have them. We have traces of his sayings in these gospels. We have traces of what Jesus may have said. For instance, in Mark chapter 12, verses 28 to 30, someone comes to Jesus and asks him, what is the greatest commandment? And he said, the greatest or the first commandment is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Right? He says the Lord our God is one, which is a statement of Tawheed, the oneness of God, which is found in the Old Testament or the Hebrew Bible in Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4. So that those are statements that are true, that are traces of the original sayings of Jesus. But to ask for a full list of all the sayings of Jesus Christ or most of the sayings of Jesus Christ, we don't have them. Christians don't have them. None of these gospels have them. These gospels have only traces of some of the occasions where Jesus said a few words here and there. So there are no formal statements. Even the speech that Jesus is supposed to have given in the Gospel of Matthew, right, where he talks about different kinds of blessings. Even in that speech, scholars argue that it was the anonymous author of the Gospel of Matthew who exaggerated that account, possibly, and added a lot of things. And this was something that was happening back in the days that, first of all, it was an anonymous author who attributed this writing to Matthew, or in fact, even the attribution to Matthew is in oral tradition, right? I'm going too much into Christian history, but all I'm trying to say is make the argument that these gospels are not authentic, and they are not considered, whether it's the Gospel of Barnabas or any of the other gospels. We don't see any of them to be authentic. They're all very exaggerated accounts of the life and times of Jesus Christ, and the same is the case with the Gospel of Barnabas. One thing I do, and of course I have not personally investigated the Gospel of Barnabas too much, but I do know that it is a later document. The Gospel of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are earlier documents, relatively speaking. They're not from the time of Jesus. We don't have any copy of these Gospels from 100 years after the crucifixion of Jesus, but they are relatively earlier as compared to other Gospels, okay? One person has asked, is this the new religion of Islam? This is from Facebook. The Ahmadiyya Muslim community has not brought anything new. We are a community established by God Almighty through His Messiah. The name of the Messiah is Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him. And I see that you asked this question about 10 minutes ago. That was the time when I was talking about the promised Messiah, and I was talking about his message. So you can learn his message by going to alislam.org. And again, I can show that to you again. If you go to alislam.org, that is alislam.org, on the top green bar, click on Promised Messiah, and you will come to a page that is dedicated to the Promised Messiah. It talks about his signs, his claims, his message, his legacy, and one book that I talked about is entitled Our Teaching, which is a selection of some of the quotations. It's an extract from the writings of the Promised Messiah, especially from Noah's Ark, where he talks about what his message is, his main message is. And there are all these books that you can read, articles that are available here for your reading pleasure. Okay, lots of questions here. One person has asked how to respond to one of the opponents of Islam, or Ahmadiyyat rather, and all the lies that they're spreading. This question is from YouTube. You see, when it comes to criticisms online, they have been there for years. I have dealt with these criticisms for more than 10 years now. They're always there online. People just come, and sometimes it's one person, and then they're lost in history, and then it's someone else, and then eventually they're also lost. So if there's an academic presentation, and the critic that you have mentioned actually came on this program and started asking me these questions as well, you know, I told him that I'm here for an academic healthy dialogue. I'm not here to talk about specific insults. I'm not here to hurl insults on anyone. So if they're going to hurl insults on the promised Messiah or on the Khulafa, this is not the place to do that. And if they don't heed the warning, they will be blocked, because this is not a place where we're just going to take on derogatory words and language and all that. This is a place for a healthy conversation, a healthy dialogue, a constructive dialogue. If you disagree with me, with the Ahmadiyya Muslim beliefs, then bring your case or ask a question, and I can respond to that, and we can talk about it. But to just simply come here and say negative things about personalities is not going to get us anywhere. All right, so keep that in mind. And so in the case that you have presented, in that case as well, just be patient. No need to respond to filthy language with filthy language. No need to lose your emotions. Stick to the academic arguments. Many of the answers are available on alislam.org. And if you feel that there is an argument or a criticism or an allegation that is very popular that you feel we should respond to, my email here is askanimam@alislam.org. Send me that email and I will, inshallah, consider it to have a formal response given to that, and those kinds of allegations. And Al-Islam is working on that, and there are other Jamaat websites that are working on that as well. So we can definitely look into responding to those things in a better way. All right? I hope that makes sense to you. One question from Twitter. Do you believe Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last prophet? The answer is yes, we believe him to be the last law-bearing prophet. He brought the last law, the last Sharia, and he brought the last book, which is the Holy Quran. The Holy Quran is the last book of guidance for humanity. The Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought the last book, brought the last law. Anyone who claims to be a new prophet, anyone who claims that the law of Islam is obsolete or the law of the Quran is obsolete is a false prophet, and no one can come and challenge him. The one exception is for a prophet to come who is a follower of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is something that is taught to us in the Holy Quran, and this is something that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself predicted. For instance, at one occasion he said, "Laysa bayni wa baynahu nabiyyun wa innahu nazilun," that between me and him, the promised Messiah, there is no prophet. Right, so the promised Messiah would be a prophet, and he would descend by the will of God Almighty. Similarly, at another occasion, he referred to the promised Messiah as Nabiullah, the prophet of Allah, several times. And in the Holy Quran, we have one verse of the Holy Quran that talks about this, is in chapter 4, verse 70. If you go to alislam.org, at the bottom, click on Quran, go. And then it brings you to the page, the index of the chapters of the Holy Quran. And then on the top here, you have a drop-down menu on the word verse. You don't see me opening the drop-down, but it's there. And you can select verse number 70. And it says, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ وَمَنْ يُطِيَ اللَّهَ وَالرَّسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ أَنَعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنَ النَّبِيِّينَ والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين وحسن أولئك رفيقا. And whoso obeys Allah and this messenger of his, that is the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, shall be among those on whom Allah has bestowed his blessings, namely the prophets, the truthful, the martyrs, and the righteous. So it is whoever obeys Allah and the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so whoever is a follower of Allah and the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam can be bestowed with the blessing of prophethood. This is very clear from this verse of the Holy Quran. All right. Do you also believe that Hazrat Ahmad is the Imam Mahdi? Yes, we believe that Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, is the Imam Mahdi. He is the promised Imam Mahdi who was to come in the latter days. One person on Facebook has asked, is this in England, this Facebook video? No, this is not necessarily in England. It's in different countries. It's myself and some other imams in different countries. We present these videos. Okay, these are Ask an Imam videos. Question from YouTube again. How can somebody be humble or have humility and at the same time be very confident? You see, confidence and arrogance are two different things. Okay? What we are being told is not to be arrogant in the sense that we look down upon others and we see them as lesser than us. Right? Seeing someone as lesser than us would be arrogance. But being confident, having reliance on Allah, tawakkul on Allah, that He will allow us to do what we want to do if it's a good act, and with prayers, with sadaqah, we do something good, that confidence is a totally different thing. It has nothing to do with arrogance, because that's just your reliance on God to help you through what you're doing, and that has nothing to do with you looking down on anybody else or saying that no one else can do this or no one else has the power or the ability to do this. So that's the difference between confidence and arrogance. So you can be humble and yet be confident at the same time. You're humble in the sense that you're always turning to God, you're always humble in your prayers, you're always asking for His help, and you're never thinking that I somehow have the ability to do the best or no one else can do this. But at the same time, you're confident with your reliance on prayers and your tawakkul on, and your trust on God Almighty. I hope that made it clear for you. All right, bunch of questions that I wanted to show you on screen as well. Excuse me. What is the best prayer against our enemies as per Ahmadiyya? Well, there is the prayer that Hazur-e Anwar, our Caliph, our Khalifa, Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmad, may Allah be his helper, has mentioned even in the latest khutbah from Friday, December 25th, which is Allahumma inna naj'aluka fi nuhurihim wa na'uzu bika min shururihim. Somehow it skipped my mind. Actually, let's confirm that by going to alislam.org and going to the latest Friday sermon, which is in the library drop-down menu at the top. And we have December 25th. We have the khutbah. So let me see if they put this, the prayer. Well, they didn't put the Arabic here, but these are the prayers that Hazur talked about at the end of his sermon. Okay. And he talked about how Ahmadis should be, offer certain prayers. Which should be offered especially by Ahmadis who have a Pakistani background or who are in Algeria or Pakistan, but other Ahmadis can also participate. So you can watch the video, go to the end and see what kind of prayers Hazur has mentioned. The full text will also appear eventually here, where we'll have the, and the Urdu text will also be available here right now. It's not there. Let me see if the Urdu is there. And okay, so will we have to go to the Urdu khutbah page, 25th December? They don't have the text yet, but eventually the text will appear here and you should be able to find the prayers. Yes, the other website that someone just pointed out to me is wayofseekers.ca. That's also where the prayers are listed in one of those places. So you can definitely get it from there. There's that prayer. There's Rabbi Kullu Shayin Khadimuka, Rabbi Fahfazni, Wansurni, Warhamni. which is, my Lord, all of the things are your servants. My Lord, protect me and help me. And help me against the enemies. Rabbi kullu shayin khadimuka, Rabbi fahfazni, wansurni, warhamni, and have mercy on me, right? So that's the prayer that you can offer in relation to the enemies, and you can offer prayers in your own words as well. And again, back to that khutbah of Hazur, in the end he did say some prayers in Urdu as well, that you can offer those prayers as well. Okay, the question that is just on your screen at the bottom says, what is the difference between PBUH and Alayhi Salam? PBUH means peace be upon him, and Alayhi Salam also means peace be upon him. So technically, their translation is identical. But PBUH is a short form English abbreviation for the words sallallahu alaihi wasallam, right? Peace and blessings of God be upon him, right? In our jamaat, we have reduced the use of PBUH because it can be a little bit confusing. So we do one of two things. One, we put an SA superscript, which is an indication that this is a reference to an Arabic salutation or prayer for the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Usually in our books, we indicate what SA stands for. Second option that I've also seen in our Jamaat literature is that we put the full sentence, peace and blessings of God be upon him, in brackets after the name of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So these are the two methods. I have not seen PBUH used a lot in our literature. It is still used to some extent, but in more recent literature, this is not a common form of abbreviation or adoption. We haven't adopted this quite commonly yet. All right. One person has said that he didn't know about the website wayofseekers.ca. Well, you didn't know about it probably because it's a local website. It's run by one of our local communities. It's a country-based website. Similarly, our jamaats in other parts of the world have country-based websites, but our main official website, which is linked with this live stream as well, is www.alislam.org. All right. One person has pointed out that AS is on whom be peace, right? So it's again, alayhi salam, upon him be peace, which is a similar prayer. So it's ultimately a prayer of peace for the Prophet, okay? For an esteemed personality, even some cases, we use this special prayer for them. All right, other questions. So some people have commented, so that's why the questions have gone up a little bit. Have you ever debated a Sunni imam or dialogued with any Sunni scholars? I've definitely had dialogues with them. I have had interaction with them. In our jamaat, generally speaking, we don't tend to do too many debates, one-on-one debates. And the reason is because in debates, there's a tendency to really become entrenched in your beliefs and to really become stubborn and not listen to the other side. Or there's an attempt to just put the other side down with trickery. But it's not to say that we have never been in debates. There have been a few important debates for sure. But generally speaking, we like to have dialogues. We like to have lots and lots of symposiums, colloquiums, where we talk about our faith and let the audience decide from a more neutral perspective, rather than trying to put the other person down or insult them or doing those kinds of things. So that's what we normally incline towards. And as far as that is concerned, there have been many dialogues that we have done. As far as Sunni specific dialogues are concerned, online I have interacted with many of them. There's a book that I wrote 10 years ago now that was in response to a Sunni, you can say he was a kind of a debater at that time. He had an online presence. He doesn't have that anymore, but he had that at that time, and I wrote a response to him. And the name of the book is With Love to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the Khatamun Nabiyyin. And you can find it on alislam.org. Just search for the book or my name, and this would appear on alislam.org, where you can benefit from that book. All right? If you're interested in a specific debate-like kind of a discussion with a Sunni person of a Sunni background. Okay, he wasn't a scholar, but he did try to make some arguments. One person said, I am Ahle Sunnat. Is the Ahmadiyya religion also Ahle Sunnat? First of all, Ahmadiyya religion, again, is not a separate religion per se to suggest that Ahmadiyyat is bringing something new or something different or anything like that. The Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat, our belief is in Islam. We are Muslims. We are Ahmadi Muslims. So to suggest that we have brought a new religion or that Ahmadiyya is a religion would be a misunderstanding. Ahmadiyya is not a religion. It is Islam, which is our religion. To specify our distinctiveness within Islam, we say we are Ahmadi Muslims. Now, you have said that you are Ahle Sunnat. Ahle Sunnat wal Jamaat also have different groups among them. They are the Diobandis, there are Brailvis who will also say that they are Ahle Sunnat. So Ahle Sunnat is a broader group or classification. It is not very specific. But as far as our beliefs are concerned, if you're talking about the broader beliefs of the Ahle Sunnat, many of the broader beliefs of the Ahle Sunnat are probably identical with the beliefs of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. And this is pointed out by the Promised Messiah alayhi salam in one of his books. I believe the name of that book is Nishane Asmani. Let me recall that by going to alislam.org. If you go to alislam.org, on the top it says Promised Messiah. Click on Promised Messiah and then scroll down to the place where his books are mentioned. And in these books, I believe that book has been translated. It is called Nishane Asmani in Urdu. And let me quickly, yes, it's one of these two books. It's either The Heavenly Sign or The Heavenly Decree, where the Promised Messiah, peace be upon him, talks about his position in regards to the Ahle Sunnat. I believe it's The Heavenly Decree. It is addressed to the contemporary ulama and declared him a non-Muslim. So he responds to them and he talks about his beliefs. So, and he talks about the criteria of a true believer. So this is the book Asmani Fasla. Then this is the Urdu title of this book. That's where you would find the Promised Messiah speaking about his views being very similar to the Ahle Sunnat wal Jamaat, which includes a belief in the Holy Quran, the Ahadith, in the truthfulness of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all those things that would make a person a Muslim. They are laid out in this book. All right, I'm just scrolling up here to see if there are any other questions. I'm getting a lot of questions today. I appreciate all of you who have joined this program and joined me. I know that sometime in the past I got some a busy schedule where I could not do these live streams more regularly. I do hope that from going forward I will be able to do these live streams more often. And I hope to see you more and more. Okay, I have covered most of the questions. What are some of the signs and prophecies that are supposed to take place in the future? I'll give you a quick example. There is one prophecy that is about meeting extraterrestrial life, And you can simply go to alislam.org in the top search bar, type in extraterrestrial life, and there is a prophecy in the Quran about meeting extraterrestrial life that you can read about here. It is something that is going to happen in our future. That is a very interesting prophecy if you want to learn more about it. Can you go into where the substitution theory came from and how do we prove that it has no place in Islam? Substitution theory, this is a question about substitution theory. In Islam, it's something that wasn't there in the early days. You know, the one understanding that the Sahaba commonly had at the very beginning was that all messengers have passed away. And you can say that this was an ijma, this was a consensus of the Sahaba, of the companions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam at the time of his passing. When the Sahaba were gathered and some of them were saying that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has not passed away, and especially Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu is saying that he has just gone into heaven and he's going to return, and no one should say that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has passed away. And Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu came to them, told Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu to sit down, and then he recited a verse of the Holy Quran which translates into that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is a messenger of Allah. Verily, all messengers have passed away before him. So everyone was stunned, and you know, this was something that was just clearly established at that time, that all messengers have passed away, and the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has also passed away. So we do know that is what happened, and to suggest that even at that time, some of the Sahaba believed that Jesus Christ went to heaven would be wrong, because otherwise one of them would have gotten up and challenged Hazrat Abu Bakr and said that, what about Hazrat Isa alayhi salam? Did he not go into the heavens? Was there not a substitution? So this substitution theory must have come later on. It must have been suggested by other scholars who came later on. Who exactly proposed this? I don't know. I have not personally investigated this. It's an interesting question. You can always go to alislam.org and type in substitution theory and see if there are any articles, research articles on substitution theory. But it's definitely a good point to study the history and trace the history of this belief. But nevertheless, there have always been eminent Muslim scholars who believe that Jesus Christ passed away a natural death. There are ahadith talking about the passing away of Jesus Christ after a certain period of time. So definitely those people who are narrating those ahadiths they believe that Jesus Christ passed away. There are historical narrations. There are statements of a very important ulama, even Imam Malik, who clearly said that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, has passed away. Hazrat Ibn Abbas, so we have a lot of Imam Bukhari, the compiler of the Sahih Bukhari. All these people believed that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, passed away a natural death. But of course, there have been other groups who believed in other things about Jesus Christ. So this is just how history works, where there are different opinions on different matters of religion. All right. One person has asked from Facebook that, what is the belief of Ahl Sunnat with regards to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, as they believe he was elevated physically, but what do they believe, what actually happened that day? As I'm in conversation with my Sunni friend, but she doesn't know exactly what happened that day. Was there another person crucified instead of him? That's what some of the Ahl Sunnat suggest. That Jesus Christ never went to the cross. Someone looked like him who was put on the cross, and Jesus Christ, meanwhile, was taken up into heaven. And how exactly that happened, there are numerous narrations about it. Some say he disappeared. Some say that the roof opened up and he went into heaven. All kinds of narrations about that. One of the first problems with this theory is that if someone else had been made to appear like Jesus, and some say it was Judas Iscariot who was made to appear like Jesus, who was put on the cross, Judas could have easily easily said that he's not Jesus Christ. He could have pointed to his, could have come to that place and could have said that this is not Jesus, this is Judas, right? So it's a very strange theory for someone else to have just been put on the cross without any attempt on his part to try to save himself from that situation. So this theory actually creates more doubts and more questions than answers. The straightforward theory, or not the theory, but rather the fact, is that Jesus Christ did go on the cross. The only part is in relation to how long he was on the cross. So for a person to die days, it could take up to a week in some cases, because once a person is on the cross, the way to death is usually starvation. Right? And of course, starvation doesn't happen in 2 or 3 hours. Jesus Christ was there on the cross for something like 1 hour or 2 hours or 3 hours, right? So he wasn't there for a very long, even half a day. He wasn't even on it for a quarter of a day. So when it comes to Jesus Christ, he did not die on the cross. He was put on the cross, but he didn't die on the cross. He was taken down alive. And this is a big subject, and there are many things that I have not covered. So I suggest that you go on alislam.org and you check out this book, which is called Jesus in India. Jesus in India. Type in Jesus in India on alislam.org search bar. So you have this book, Jesus in India, and I've just straight up opened the PDF, but you can also go to the page where other formats are also available, PDF, Apple Books, Google Play, Kindle, and all these other formats. So you can read this book in any of these formats that you prefer. And in this book, the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, has explained all of this very beautifully. And so I suggest that if you want to know really what happened to Jesus Christ, go through this book. It will give you a clear picture of what happened on that day. All right. I have a lot of questions. Of course, I would not be able to get to all of them, but I will try. Okay. Let me go to the latest question. So there is some discussion here. Someone is already suggesting some books, and I appreciate that. One person has asked about Zulkarnain, right? And Zulkifl. Well, in order to know more about them, one of the first things that I do suggest is that you go to alislam.org and you find the verse where Zulkifl and Zulkarnain are mentioned. I'm going to just do an English search and see if Zulkarnain. I type in Zulkarnain here, and you see that I found a couple of verses where he is mentioned. So there is chapter 18, verse 95, where he's mentioned. So all you need to do is click on chapter 18, verse 95, the link to that, and then you will come to the page where you have the short commentary, long commentary, and then you can just click on the long commentary or the short commentary notes here, and you'll get this detailed explanation of who Zulkarnain was, and you can get a better idea, see the verse in context. So as I'm running out of time, I can't go into all these details. The same thing you can do with Zulkifl, right? Go to that relevant verse, find it through the search, and just look into the commentary, and you will get the points from right here on alislam.org. All you have to do, all you need is a phone, tablet, whatever device you have, and go to those pages and find out more about Zulkarnain and Zulkifl. All right. Did the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, believe in the theory of substitution that we were talking about earlier? He did not initially, he basically in the early days, before God sent him those revelations about the death of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he just reiterated the common beliefs about Jesus Christ. And in one of his earliest books, the early portions of Brahini Ahmadiyya, he has mentioned about Jesus and just reiterated the commonly held notions about Jesus Christ. But later on, God, through God's revelations, and then eventually his own research that confirmed all those revelations, and he went to great lengths to do this research, field research, literature research, books research, all that. Based on that, he came, he had a very firm conviction that Jesus Christ actually passed away in Srinagar, Kashmir, which is in present-day India. Okay? And again, you can go to Jesus in India and you can read more about him you can read about all this evidence better in that book. All right. There is some communication here. I've actually lost track of the number of comments I've received today, so I can't moderate it as best as I would like to, but I'll take the latest questions that I've just received. One question is that did Jesus, peace be upon him, speak as a baby? So the Quran talks about him as speaking in the cradle. Now that is a metaphor in the Quran. It just goes to show that Jesus Christ started speaking very well at a very young age. He was a gifted child. He was chosen by God at a young age to become a prophet of God, and from that young age he said very wise things. All right. So this is discussed in the verses, and what you can do is search in the Quran the word cradle. I believe that's the word that is used there. It says, how can we talk to one who is a child in the cradle? Right. This is yukallimun nasa fil mahdi wa kahlam wa min as-salihin, and he shall speak to the people in the cradle and men of middle age, and he shall be of the righteous. Fil mahdi is just a metaphor of the language that from a very young age he would speak very wisely to the people, and that is true in the case of Jesus Christ as a prophet of God. At a young age, he said very wise things based on the knowledge granted to him by God Almighty. What is the book title in Urdu that I spoke about? I guess you're referring to Jesus in India. The Urdu title is Masih Hindustan Mein, if that is what you are asking. Okay, question about Dajjal. Does Allah care about the preservation of his religion? If so, what is the way that he has ensured that Muslims have been following the true Islam for the past 1400 years? Of course, Allah cares about people following the true path, the true religion, and have the guidance. As far as the history of Islam is concerned, Allah has told us that first there will be a period of Khilafat, which is the rightly guided Khulafa. And then after that, Allah has said that there will be Mujaddideen, there will be people who will revive the faith at the head of every century. And throughout the history of Islam, we have had Mujaddideen who have appeared. And then eventually Allah says, it was in the prophecies of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Messiah would come, the promised Messiah would come, and he has appeared, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him. And after him, we have a system of caliphate. The Khilafat has reappeared in the latter days on the precepts of prophethood. So, prophecies have been fulfilled, and we see that through the coming of the Khulafa and then the Mujaddideen and then the Awliya and then eventually the promised Messiah and his Khulafa, he has kept the right path of Islam visible to all the people. Whether or not people accept the right path in their millions or billions, that's another question. But the right path has always been there for people to choose to find it and sincerely follow the right path. All right? Okay, one more question before we come to the conclusion. One question, technical question, is that is this recorded? This program is being, you know, whichever you are asking this question from YouTube. Yes, right now it's live, but later on you can come back and check, and the recording will be available for you to watch if you like. All right, one more question about the Dajjal. Again, this is a very big question, and I can't answer it in detail. And by the way, this would be my last question about the Dajjal. Someone asked, "What is the position?" Regarding the Dajjal, one thing you should always remember is that the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that in order to safeguard yourselves from the influences of the Dajjal, you should recite the first and last 10 verses of Suratul Kahf. You should recite the first and last 10 verses of Suratul Kahf. So when we read the first and last 10 verses of Suratul Kahf, we find mention of the belief that Jesus Christ is the literal Son of God. Now, that belief, the Quran refutes that in the first 10 verses of Suratul Kahf. And in the last 10 verses of Suratul Kahf, they talk about materialism. So when we look at this, the real Dajjal then is the latter day nations who would be Christian, powerful Christian nations. It appears to be a reference to that. Similarly, the word Dajjal it refers to the plural. The word Dajjal, where it comes from, it means deceit. So any kind of deceit or deception in the name of religion, and in some cases this is done by Muslims, right? Muslim scholars can sometimes be deceitful and say things that are meant to deceive others. So wherever this kind of deception is, it's part of the Dajjal. So in the latter days, there would be much deception that would spread on earth. And that is what this is referring to. And that is what we are up against. We are combating this deception so that we can bring people back to the true religion, the one true faith, which is Islam. So this is a broad answer, but of course you can go to alislam.org, simply type in Dajjal, and you will find a number of articles that talk about the Dajjal, some videos as well that talk about the Dajjal that you can just go to and listen to or read in order to increase your understanding and your knowledge about the Dajjal. I truly, truly appreciate all of you who joined me today and sent so many messages. I could not get to all the messages because there were so many. I really do appreciate it. Please do remember me and the alislam.org team in your prayers, and please help us spread the information about our website, which is www.alislam.org. More and more people should know about this website and the resources that are available on this website. Jazakumullah and assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.